This is Breaking Down Security, and I am Brian Brake. Welcome back, listener. This is Brian. And unfortunately, Mr. Betcher is out again this week for a family issue. It's nothing emergency. It's just there was an event that came up, and I told him he should go to it because family is first before the podcast. So he will not be with us this week. He will be with us next week with another exciting interview. This is very interesting because this is the first time we've ever had two guests on the show, and they both have Wikipedia pages. That's how famous they are. They have Wikipedia pages. I think they're just a little bit below like Jeopardy question. If they get Jeopardy questions, then they're just going to be like on fire. So this week is Mr. Gene Kim and Mr. Josh Corman. Welcome to the show, gentlemen. I'm very excited to have both of you here today.
Hey, Brian. This is Gene. Hey, so delighted to be on with you. And holy cow, I love the fact that I'm on with Josh Corman, my good buddy.
Right on.
I love you, Gene.
I love you, man.
So for listeners who don't know who either one of you are, could we start with an intro on who you gentlemen are? We'll start with Gene, and then we'll go to Josh.
Yeah, absolutely, Brian. I've been studying high-performing technology organizations since 1999, and that's a journey that started for me back when I was the CTO and founder of a company called Tripwire in the information security space that I still love so dearly. And one of the biggest surprises is that it took me into the DevOps movement. And so co-wrote a book called The Phoenix Project, and a book that just came out today is called The DevOps Handbook, which I'm just so thrilled that it's finally here after 5.5 years of work. And a lot of this journey has been shared with my friend Josh Corman.
All right.
I'm Josh Corman. I'm a longtime cybersecurity guy. Trying to think what's most relevant to today. Probably I've been deeply concerned about the relationship between technology and the human condition for most of my career. But over time, I kind of, you know, bumped into people like Gene, and I realized that we need radically different approaches to software and IT if we're going to start putting software and connectivity into more of our lives. So originally wrote the Rugged Software Manifesto and helped start that meme and movement with a few other folks, which eventually became Rugged DevOps. And now I'm actually working on public safety and human life issues in the public policy arenas with a group called IAmTheCavalry.org.
Yep. IAmTheCavalry has been going on for a while. You guys were working on like healthcare security with like and then car. Are we doing some car stuff as well, right? Car security and car securing protocols on that.
Yep, that's probably the two biggest pockets of work. Because look, it's one thing to have cruddy software on a PHP web server; it's another entirely when that cruddy software can get your brakes shut off.
Yeah, exactly. All right, so that's a nice segue. Speaking of cruddy software, we're here. So we're talking about DevOps, and you know, one of the things that came up in our this is actually born out of a Twitter conversation between Mr. James Jardine and Josh Corman. We asked James to come on. He was going to come on, but unfortunately, they're in the midst of a little bitty storm that's going on down in Florida called Hurricane Michael, Category 4, and he was not able to join us this evening. So we will definitely try to get him on at some point in the future to talk about his side of the story. So he said it started out as is it SecDevOps or DevSecOps? Why don't we just save the hassle and call it DevOps and make security a default part of it instead of an add-on? Josh replied, for what it's worth, the target teams don't like a mangling of their team, hence the leaders like Rugged DevOps, CCing Bacha Galoop and Jez Humble. I think we asked them both on too, but unfortunately they weren't able to make it. So it goes on. I'll actually post the Twitter picture later. He said we have to. His last little tweet before I replied that we should come on was, it's easier to learn the right the first time than have to relearn once a bridge is created. Two people are choosing between the two. So you were talking about desired state and current state. So
yeah.
What is the why is it always seems like that security is a bolt on not only just to DevOps but pretty much everything? Embedded security, any application out there. I mean, we've talked to Ben Caudill about application logic flaws, where it's like they build these things trying to be first to market, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh yeah, we now have to care about security. Why is it that security seems to be a bolt-on instead of something that is done right the first time? I'm going to go with Josh because we did the intros to Gene.
Well, I mean, there's lots of answers to your question, but one of them is that it's human nature to adopt things for their immediate and obvious benefits, but we don't do the cost-benefit analysis until we have a pretty big mistake. Mm-hmm. So we're generally trusting in our nature, and we think that, you know, what's the phrase that Kevin Fu found with why we put Bluetooth into insulin pumps? It was, he finally found the engineer that did it, and he goes, well, everything's better with bacon, everything's better with Bluetooth. And
oh, wow.
So once they started putting, you know, Bluetooth into their devices, all their competitors had to do it because it's cool. Mm. But, you know, in physical engineering, there's a lot we can learn. You know, we didn't used to have fire escapes, and there was some pretty bad fires in some of the mill working in New York. So now you used to have these bolt-on, literally bolt-on fire codes where you have those metal wrought iron fire escapes on the outside of buildings. They're ugly, they rust, they fall apart. But eventually we realized, okay, if you look in a modern hotel, the fire escape is a very wide, internally constructed tower in the hotel at one end or another. And if the hotel burns down, it will still be standing. You know, we kind of decided that the most structurally sound and safe way to have fire escapes is built into the architecture. And we're going to figure that out for these high, these safety critical or high consequence of failure software applications, but we're only going to find out after we have some really, really big mistakes.
Mm-hmm. So Gene, same question to you. I would ask as a follow-on, is it because developers, it's not in their thought process to think in a secure manner? They're thinking just in terms of code?
So much of my experience in information security, I think, would also... Yeah, I think the conclusion could be that no one cares about security, certainly not ops people, certainly not developers. But early in my journey studying high performers, you know, the first kind of aha moment was seeing just how, you know, passionately, you know, certain ops people cared about this. And that was sort of the genesis of the high performing organizations, was, you know, those people who thought that, you know, what's good for ops is good for security and vice versa. And, you know, I think for me, the even bigger aha moment was that, you know, there's the same sort of kindred spirits in development. And, you know, I think that that sort of early discoveries, you know, I think really primed me that, you know, when I saw the DevOps movement, it was just such a, it was so obvious that this was what we were looking for. You know, I think, you know, there's a great saying that, you know, it's impossible to write code that's available, you know, if it can be compromised, you know, trivially, right? So, mm-hmm. you know, security is just another non-functional requirement, just like performance, just like quality, just like scalability and so forth. And so, you know, I think I have empathy for any security practitioner who feels like they are doomed to be the shrill, hysterical person who's is viewed as shrill and hysterical, focusing on minutia, and who's always marginalized by the organization. But Josh, you know, once said to me, that for me was just memorable, was unforgettable, was, you know, there is a community out there who is waiting for information security professionals with open arms, right? And, you know, I think the DevOps movement is all about that, that really it is the full integration of the information security objectives into the software development lifecycle from every stage, whether it's ideation, architecture, design, development, you know, operations, and so forth. And, you know, what we found is, you know, over the last 4 years is that, you know, the DevOps movement has done amazing things for dev and ops. They can, they deploy code 200 times more frequently. They do it 2,500 times more quickly. They have one half the failures. They can fix issues 200 times more quickly. But this year, we found this other amazing dimension of quality as well. They are spending one half the amount of time remediating security issues. So, you know, even though it may seem less formal, you know, the outcomes are so much better. And so, you know, the notion that DevOps don't want us, you know, and us being security, is, you know, I think, you know, flat out false, right? I just, you know, someone who feels that, I understand that, but there is a community out there who is actually actively seeking great information security kung fu.
It's there's also, we have some cultural defects in the cybersecurity or information security realm, in that we kept bringing a pointing finger instead of a helping hand, and we kept pointing out individual failures instead of classes of design choices that might lead to things, symptoms versus root causes. Mm-hmm. And I always had some sort of love-hate for OWASP, for example, because they had the OWASP top 10, and we never crossed anything off the list year after year. And I found that while it was really good supply of free technical tools, they hadn't really figured out the soft skills and the social skills to kind of create the cultural demand. So part of the instinct to write the Rugged Software Manifesto and have a word like agile, like rugged, that's affirmative and positive. It's all the things you want. You want available, survivable, sustainable, quality code. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's because like a couple of us in AppSec, I started in software QA. So I watched these guys not care at all about memory leaks. Then we start realizing, okay, memory corruption, memory growth, memory leaks, they tend to hurt our customers. So we start using Purify and looking for array bound read and writes. And initially they were furious with us because they're like, oh, my code compiles, ship it. Yeah. You're a whiner. But as soon as they kind of internalized it, integrated it, saw the consequences, the same developers came back 2 months later and said, I defy you to find any memory leaks in my code. And I felt like maybe we just hadn't found the right nut or approach from the security realm, that you can't just push security for security's sake or these hypotheticals. Mm-hmm. And a real aha really came from Rich Mogul. He had this great line that when he was an ambulance driver or an EMT, he said, any strategy that depends on a change in human nature is a strategy that's going to fail. And I think the reason I was so drawn to Gene's work on the DevOps stuff is that these guys figured out how to develop empathy first and figure out how their upstream and downstream choices affected other people towards common measurements. And what that helped us do is some security is going to stink, right? It's going to be attacks. It's going to be a burden. No one really wants to do it. But we found these massive areas where if you make a smart set of decisions that in your threat modeling, in your design, in your platform implementation languages, if you reduce elective attack surface, elective chaos and entropy, or you pick better suppliers, we started finding these things that I don't tell them that Heartbleed is a security risk. I say Heartbleed was unplanned, unscheduled work. Mm-hmm. And it made you context switch and you were late. You weren't on time, on budget. And when I talked to ops people, I didn't call it security either. I said you had a break fix or a service interruption. It hurt your 5.9s. And it extended your mean time to identify and mean time to remediate. And if you started using their language, I'm like, oh, wait, we have some common ground here to have better software supply chains. And I'm like, they love Deming for Lean. They love Deming for Agile. They love Deming for DevOps and TQM and Six Sigma. Let's steal the one thing from Deming we haven't stolen yet, which is his Toyota supply chain principles. And we start realizing that, just like Gene mentioned, if you can take – pay closer attention to the third-party open source projects you use. You don't use known vulnerable versions of them, and you track where they go. We started seeing these massive improvements in the key performance indicators and bonus measurements of dev and ops people to massively cut down on rework, and then their efficiency goes through the roof. So instead of a security person like blaming them for unparameterized input validation and stuff like that, you had the security people actually giving them that next boost of efficiency and productivity simply by helping them pick better software supply chain stuff.
Excellent. So it sounds like some of it is a culture or a terminology shift on the information security side. And it also requires, developers to embrace the unexpected that will come from, with the various software development lifestyle processes, you have, a set amount of things that are going to get done in a sprint or what have you. So they have to schedule for some of these unknown unknowns. So it's a terminology issue, or it's a culture shift on the InfoSec side, and it's a bit of unexpected on the dev side.
Yeah, I think it's more than certainly yes. Absolutely. But, I think that also underplays, I think that's how radically different the development environment can be with things like continuous integration, continuous tests, and so forth. I mean, in the bad old days, and let's forget about security for a moment, often developers, we would be working for months, maybe even a year before we would get any feedback on our work. In other words, I could make an error today, mm-hmm. and I might not detect the error or the huge performance problem until 9 months later when we're doing integration testing or performance testing, right? Right. And the same thing obviously happens with security. And so what is so different now is that what is being increasingly common practice is that whenever we check in code, we'll have automated tests run right away. So we will know about that error within minutes or worst case, a couple of hours. And that's not just for functional errors, but that should also be for security errors too. And so when we do this, that means the whole notion that it's no longer is the expertise just in the security professional's head. Instead, that expertise is being put into the automated tests where it can impact the quality of the work that's being done all the time. And what a massive lever that is in an amplifier of for security. I love the Capital One. They don't call it DevOps. They call it DevOpsSec, meaning that they're integrating security into the daily work of everybody in the value stream, dev, test, operations. And what I love about that is in those unit tests, in that shared source code repository, is essentially the collective expertise of the entire security organization. Every developer ideally can now deploy code quickly into production with the collective experience of all the security expertise in the organization, quickly, safely, and without having to, bug a security person or open up a ticket, when it's far too late to actually make any changes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, that's something that security people have a hard time with, but they eventually figure out is that while they may not be able to do a 3-day full static analysis of their codes as a gating function anymore when you're doing code pushes once an hour, what they don't realize is if you notice a flaw, you can fix it in an hour potentially, right? So the idea to have those faster cycles, right now I call it the cycle time squeeze, because they keep trying to find cheaper, dumber ways to do code analysis. And they're not doing deep, thorough analysis. And I said this to one of the CTOs at an AppSec company. I'm like, stop fighting this. When we were in QA, you do a smoke test, a unit test, a full system regression test. You don't just pick one. So let's do something like every single hour with a tight cycle time in continuous integration process. And let's do an out-of-band, fuller, longer analysis, and then just feed it right back into the process to fix things more quickly. Because when Gene first brought DevOps on me, I said, this is the end of security as we know it, right? There's no way our stuff's going to work. And then we, about 30 seconds later, I think it was at the Chevy's restaurant in San Francisco, I said, maybe that's a good thing. What we're doing doesn't work very well anyhow. We're still missing a lot of stuff. We still have this massive backlogs of things to fix. So maybe we should try some new stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, that Chevy's is gone, Josh. I was shocked.
No.
Yeah, it's now a Brazilian steakhouse, Fogo de Chão, I think. How horrifying!
Okay. I if I can get to RSA next year, I definitely want to check out that part of San Francisco. So So anyway, getting back to the DevOps thing. So we talk about how security slows things down, or used to. I mean, now we're trying to find places to put security in, whether it be in unit testing or smoke testing, or giving developers the tools that they can use to do simple fuzzing or rudimentary fuzzing. How do you get this goes hand in hand. You talk about compliance, and people talking about NIST standards, and companies having to deal with federal contracts dealing with FedRAMP. How do you it's already bad enough that we're quote unquote slowing down the process of DevOps and continuous development and deployment with security practices. How do you make sure that things like documentation and network diagrams and data flow diagrams and application workflow diagrams all get done properly? Obviously, there has to be scheduling for it, but that gets in the way of actually developing things. How do you keep that and still have your continuous deployments?
You know, I love this one quote. It was from Justin Arbuckle. He was the chief architect at GE Capital, and now he's also in Seattle with you and at Chef. But, you know, he said, you know, the best architecture documents, whether it's, coding architecture, operations architecture, or security architecture, you know, it's not in a Word doc. It's not on a SharePoint. You know, in the ideal, it's in a shared code repository that anybody can just pull from and then inherit all the, the best known knowledge of the organization. And so that could be like, the two-factor authentication libraries that are already pre-configured for us that, you know, are already pre-blessed by the security organization. Or it could be, it could be the environment that's already hardened. It's not a Word doc that says, here's how you harden a build. It is actually the build that you can actually ideally spin up, with maybe one command line, right? And it's running in Docker in 50 milliseconds, right? That any developer can use, whenever they need to at the earliest stages of the project. I mean, that's so different than, the hardening checklists, right? And the fact that people are turning these hardening checklists into, Docker images that, have pre-hardened applications, pre-hardened environments, I think is exactly where we need to go.
Yeah, it's all a blur to me how it came about, but one of my favorite moments with Gene was, before the book was written, we were talking. I basically said, "Hey, have you read this book called The Goal?" And he's like, "Oh my God, I'm recently writing The Goal for IT." but there was this moment in there where I was kind of ranting, and I said, security people keep looking for, can I squeeze one more project into the budget? Can I put one more work item onto the CIO's priority list? And I said, maybe it's not the work you put in the system. Maybe it's the work you can take out of the system. Because often it's our really old legacy systems that can't be patched, or no one's maintaining them, or you're afraid if you look at it cross-eyed, it might fall over. That tends to be the weakest point in your security profile. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I kind of think is inherent in the DevOps is almost a minimalism, or this retreat from these monolithic, massive mega apps to, more Strack, lean, auditable, reviewable microservices and reuse and getting rid of waste. And all those things, if you can focus on having less code, right? And we already know there's a certain defect rate per 1,000 lines of code, and we have millions and millions of lines of code. So when you can focus on just taking a meat cleaver to how much attack surface you have inherently, and if you can get the hygiene good on those shared services, and you could have it something that someone can actually review instead of just glance at, these aren't necessarily done for security outcomes, but they happen to massively reduce the entropy and attack surface with security benefit. So sometimes it's just leveraging the natural momentum of DevOps to find better ways to hit the objectives of security instead of trying to, port forward all the old practices that we had.
I love the rhetorical skills of Josh. I mean, that's certainly one of them is, is there a way to rework the system so that it's just not more work, right? And I think so much of that, I guess one of the big aha moments for me was, seeing that all the problems that security was having as a community in terms of the ability to influence outcomes and the rest of the ecosystems, operations was having, right? And so I remember going to the ITO conferences in 2004, going to the Velocity conferences in the late 2000s and even DevOps days, right? I mean, what was so immediately obvious was, how much system administrators in ops, felt just the same way that, we do in information security, right? Always being brought in too late, always at the mercy of developers. In fact, one of my favorite scenes from the Phoenix project is, when they finally get the horrendous catastrophic release stabilized, the developers are throwing a party, but what they didn't realize was that none of the ops people could attend because they're still bailing out water, right? Things are still on fire in the data center. And so, that really spoke to me just because, for every one information security person, there's probably 10 operations people, right? And so it was a larger community that was suffering from the same problems. And so I think what we both get out of DevOps, both ops and security, is there's almost the truism. It sounds almost too obvious to be useful, but by truly integrating at the earliest stages, We get all the right operational security outcomes, but you know what's amazing about DevOps is that you know the developers are also so much more productive. And I think it really took some of that automation technology to change how we worked, you know, to get those really game-changing different outcomes.
Cool. So we wanted to talk. One of the things that Mr. Jardine and Mr. Corman were talking about was the desired state and the current state. Josh, maybe you could give us some clarification of that. That was part of the Twitter conversation you and him were having. Could you give us a little clarification on that?
Yeah, I wish he was here. So I'm not trying to put words in his mouth, but as you know, being in security, we have a common trope we fall into where somebody gets a case of the supposedas, like you know, well, it should be like this, and yeah. You know. You kind of, I don't think we should accept the way things are. And I don't think we can just wish them away to be something else. You have to build the bridge from the current state to desired state. Mm-hmm. And you often can't, when there's a cultural gap or a knowledge gap, or we don't even train security in your undergraduate degrees for computer science. You know, every physical engineer has to take some sort of ethics or architecture design or hazard analysis. We don't really do that yet. So we can't just snap our fingers and say, well, let's just call it DevOps and security should be baked in. That felt like a supposed to kind of sentiment. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that's in his heart. I think it's just we often emote our frustration. So I think if you don't call it out in some way, shape, or form, it could easily – you could do the DevOps without really considering secure architecture design, code selection, platforms, et cetera. So I think for some transition period – you need something that catches them. We're having the same issue in the safety critical areas. If you say security, and for car companies, they hear privacy. And if you say safety, they hear, oh, crash testing. And they can't imagine that there's this thing in the middle, which is, you know, bits and bytes that cause loss of life of them. And so we had to use this stupid word like cyber safety just to make them do a double take. Because one on the other, they completely jump to existing frames. So I think for the time being, what we noticed when we finally started building trust with, you know, the pioneers in the DevOps community was they hated DevSecOps, they hated SecDevOps, they hated DevOpsSec, although to Gene's point, one of our good buddies in the industry does call it that. But they just felt like it was security people trying to come late to the party and mess up their meme, their baby. They loved it. And, you know, I'm partial to it because of the rugged software manifesto, but they also didn't kind of hate the rugged thing. It sounded affirmative. It wasn't finger pointy. Everybody they met under that lens were trying to enhance DevOps, not reinvent it.
Sure.
So at least, you know, for the people that run DevOps days or the podcast or the whatnot, a lot of us kind of don't really care what we call it, but I'm kind of tired of security people coming late to the party and saying how everyone else should stop and do it their way. I don't think we're going to win friends and influence people. We have to show immediate value. We have to subordinate to their tribe. We have to figure out what makes their tribe tick. And I just think picking a term that we like and shoving it down their throats has not proven to be very successful.
So what you're saying is DevOps is like a different country, and once you immigrate to that country, you kind of have to get into the culture and understand it before you can start making changes on your own.
Well, I think it's you find their rhythm and their style, and then it becomes pretty easy to actually inject good complementary things in there, as opposed to just, you know, saying, you know, telling another country how to act, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But, you know, one of the things that the very first talks that really woke me up after Gene said, go look at this DevOps stuff. It was Theo, right? It was, he said, it's not DevOps. It's not, you know, it's really Star Ops. In fact, you know, it's pretty much everything ops. And he kind of hated the term DevOps, and I'm right there with him. It's just that if you call
it DevOps. Just explain that joke. You know, he called it dot star ops, like every department ops, which was, you know, I think it was such a brilliant characterization of, you know, kind of the inclusiveness of the DevOps community. So it really does take all these different skill sets, you know, to achieve all these amazing outcomes.
Yeah, and I almost looked at it like gears, right? You know, first gear was just doing dev without understanding the operational impact. And second gear was, let's align the incentive between dev and ops and get common tooling and line of sight. And then third gear was like, okay, let's do this rugged DevOps thing. And, you know, as you slowly weave more stuff in, you know, I was at dinner last night in the UK with Shannon Leitz. She's fond of the DevSecOps term. And we were talking about how do we craft DevOps objectives and metrics into quarterly earnings numbers for the executive chain. You know, and if you talk to Arbuckle, like he said, he sees it as compliance as code. But I love the idea of just unifying and aligning the work for plural benefits and outcomes.
Very nice.
Yeah. And by the way, Brian, I love kind of the notion of shared goals, but I think there are difficulties and complications. There aren't enough security people to go around. And I love James Wicket, right, from the security community. He's now at Signal Sciences with so many of the security team who came from Etsy. He has this great metric that I just loved. He said, in a typical enterprise, for every 100 developers, there's 10 ops people, and for every 10 ops people, there's one security person. Mm-hmm. And so it does kind of cry out for this, need for force multiplication. And, I think that scarcity of security talent who can effectively bridge into the ops world and the dev world, I mean, that's a small circle. So really, there's a large mission at hand here, which is how do we level up our skill sets of our community so that we can add value and not get left behind. And, that's something I actually feel so strongly about because, the best days are ahead of us, right? And that's obvious for some of us, but that might not be true for everybody who can't get on this, different type of career track.
Yeah, there may come a day soon, and I don't know how soon, but there may come a day where every engineer you hire on LinkedIn or through some recruiting, everyone that says they have experience with continuous integration or continuous delivery or DevOps happens to also care and know how to achieve security outcomes, right? Mm-hmm. I just don't think we're there yet. So in the meantime, I want to be able to advertise and link, supply and demand for more conscientious talent pools so they can be found and be applied to more important stuff. And, when Gene and I started talking about this software supply chain stuff, we're taking the Deming principles to maybe our third-party open source consumption. I was talking about efficiency or Heartbleed or things in the corporate environment. But I'm serving on the Health and Human Services Task Force for Congress right now. It's about 6 months through our 12-month thing. That ransomware that's hit thousands of U.S. hospitals and cost them a lot of time and money they don't have in the Bitcoin payoffs. In some hospitals, it actually shut down patient care, and they had to divert ambulances to other facilities. That SAMSAM attack used a known Java deserialization bug in JBoss in one device, and it was able to maybe get people killed in a hospital. And so part of this DevOps idea isn't so much let's find and fix all the bugs. One of the benefits of that software supply chain idea is that if you start including a software bill of materials, like a list of ingredients in the software we produce as a byproduct of the build process, then when there's SAMSAM hitting one hospital on the East Coast, every other hospital administrator, without having an AppSec program or a huge security staff, they can ask a question, am I affected and where am I affected? And they could have seen, oh, wow, these devices over here have that vulnerable version of JBoss. Let's take them offline so we don't jeopardize the whole hospital. So in lieu of – this isn't even so much like making more secure code. It's just creating the transparency and the tracking to enable prompt and agile response. That's a very, familiar and absorbable and attractive thing for DevOps teams, but a really foreign and scary thing for, legacy waterfall large vendors like Oracles of the world, right? They hate that idea. So you have people like Google and Netflix and Etsy doing this voluntarily because it makes it more efficient. And the kind of goods they're putting out will be easy to do to avoid, on the next ransomware attack. You got the older dogs, they don't like this idea at all. They don't like showing their ugly bits, and they don't like sharing information, and therefore their customers are fighting blind, and they're getting hit hard. So I think part of this transformation isn't so much jamming the security things down their throat, but finding ways that you can hit secure outcomes even if you're not necessarily trying to make things perfectly secure.
Very good. Okay. let me see. I have stuff that I want to talk about, but I think it's a little more rudimentary. I'd like to discuss, ways to get security as far back as possible. That was some of the stuff that Mr. Betcher wanted to mention. But is there anything you guys, okay, so let me ask this question. What is the future?
Can we address that real quick? I mean, because I think it's a great question. I mean, this is like one of the, one of the larger aha moments for me about In fact, if you put a whole bunch of these together, I mean, they frame like one of the biggest aha moments. And this, again, came from Justin Arbuckle, former GE Capital. You know, he described this architecture transformation at GE Capital. And one of the things they started doing was just inviting security, legal, and compliance to their weekly demos. And what ended up happening was that the security people would immediately see, get an understanding of the business objectives, what they were trying to achieve, and they could give early feedback in a very informal way, right? In some ways, the opposite of kind of the formal findings, right, that you would give in a kind of a highly ritualized process. And yet the outcomes were so much better. And so I guess what I love about DevOps is it's so counter to, often common sense and common practice, and it's so controversial, right? The notion that this informal, just inviting a security person and just having them watch a demo, mm-hmm. right, could be more effective than a 4-inch thick list of formal guidance.
Sure. Yeah, because I mean, the security guy's going to think like a bad guy. That's the idea, and he'd be like, "Well, what happens if I put in, what happens if I do this? What happens if I use a web interception proxy, or and modify your request here? Or, what if I overflow your API call or something?" That's going to be things that I don't think the developer is going to be thinking about when they're building the API or building the front end on that.
Right. In fact, Tomer Goshoni, he's at HP, so he's his role is, his former role is Chief Product Security Officer. So he's responsible for all the security outcomes for the software as a service as well as the ship products. And he said something, also stunning to me. He said, 10 years ago, we would put everything into our GRC tool, right? And, we would put out a PDF file and we'd give it out to the dev teams. And he said, we've totally flipped that around. Now everything belongs in Jira or, whatever the ticketing system the developers are using, because if you don't put it there, it will never get done, right? So the output of your everything that you just talked about, they're probably doing it on a daily build or a build from the continuous build systems. They're filing those as just regular defects in the in the ticketing system, we're working around where the work is done, which I think is such a different way of working than we typically did, 5 or 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. So I have a question. When we move from, let's say you're a company that's doing traditional development and you want to move to, a more agile or more DevOps thing, environment, how long is the average to move? And maybe we could talk a little bit about, the best ways to start that. Is it an integrated, is it a phased kind of thing, or can you just go cold turkey, burn everything down and start over with DevOps and get it to work?
I'll speak just briefly to that. These are the questions that we set out to answer when I started hosting a conference called the DevOps Enterprise Summit. And the goal was really to understand, where are people starting, who's driving these transformations, where do they start? What outcomes were they able to deliver? And, I think one of the big surprises was that, I think the preconceived notion was that DevOps is being driven by rogue dev managers going straight to the cloud. I think that was a common narrative that, I had really subscribed to. The big surprise was that among the speaker population, the top title was Director of Operations, followed by Chief Architects, followed by Director of Development. I actually just learned of an organization, Service Master, where the DevOps movement was actually started by security after reading the Phoenix Project. It was this awesome moment. You're talking about the tail wagging the dog, right? So I don't think there's many of those, but
I hope there are. I mean, every time we talk to security crowds, we're like, don't fight this thing. Lead it, introduce it, take your teams to lunch, like buy them the Phoenix Project. Like, this is the best chance you're going to get.
That's just so great, Josh. I mean, you're so right. I mean, no one has more to gain than security, right? Because, in terms of the amount of benefits we get compared to, the rest of the organization we get to mobilize, it is just a phenomenal opportunity. And the last thing I'll mention on this to your question, Brian, is, in general, I think the pattern is pretty clear, is people are starting, in one business unit, And they're proving such successes that the organization sees the value they're creating. We found that 25% of the speaker population has been promoted at least once in over the last 3 years, many more than once. And often they're being put in a role where they're now in a staff position where essentially they're being asked to help elevate the state of the practice of the entire organization. And so that could be often thousands of engineers. So, and I think this fits a larger pattern that we see, called disruptive innovation, where, when organizations need to do things differently, this is typically the way it starts. Josh, you've been at the conference for many years. How does that resonate with your reflections and observations?
Yeah, I think for your tribes, it's pretty consistent. One of the things I try to get more of the bridge building with the traditional security people and the traditional dev people. And what I'm a little less wedded to one true way or one true path. One of the things that David Mortman likes to say when we do these like rugged DevOps days or these little half cons at other conferences, he says, just automate something, anything, but take something that's painful for security or compliance and do something small. And then you build the permission because you removed pain, you build the permission to try something else. So I think some of these things get wrapped around the axle when they try to go too big too soon. I mean, create that really stark contrast between your experiment and something else. And I'm also just a big fan of parallel experimentation, right? Try things, fail small, iterate. And what that kind of led me to is one of the easiest ones to do that with one of the bigger gains is what I blitzed past it before, but this idea of third-party open source supply chain principles. We worked with one of the financial services guys, and he was a huge BSIM fan, still is, probably the best AppSec program I've ever seen over the course of the 15 years I've known him. But I said, let's try some of these Deming principles. And he goes, well, what do you mean? I said, well, you can use fewer and better projects. Like, do you need every logging framework or just a couple? Number two, you can use the highest quality parts from those suppliers. So maybe the don't allow every version in the sun. We had one bank using like 81 versions of Spring concurrently in production. And you have like Google who tries to use only two, right? They claim one, but it ends up being two. And then I said, and also if you trace this bill of material stuff, when there's a bash bug or a shell shock or something, you can do really, really prompt mean time to identify, mean time to repair. And he's like, you know what? I can't do all of those this year. I just spent all my political capital, but I'll do one of them. We'll use your projects. So he passed a hat around to the various team leads for the security projects and said, look, tell me which projects you want people using for logging, and I'll enforce that. And tell me which ones you don't want using, and I'll enforce that. He didn't really push them hard on which ones had better security hygiene. But as they started to kind of say, these are older, they're not as well maintained, they have more bugs, they winnowed it down to like the top three logging frameworks across his thousands of developers. He got 30% boost in developer productivity. The security guy introduced the concept of using fewer total projects for more developer portability and less maintenance and less unplanned work. And, his bug rate started going down. And, we just did a bunch of these little experiments. He went from 10 critical and high defects per 1,000 lines of code, or 10,000 lines of code, down to 7. Then after the third experiment, got down to 1. And then he said, I'm going to go crazy. Let's do some Docker in production. And he started using Docker containers. He's down to 0.1 critical and high security defects per 10,000 lines of code. His personal best was already the best in the world. And in less than 1 year with these little experiments, he just keeps showing the business that he's boosting productivity, cutting down on help desk calls, compressing mean time to fix things. And this is a security guy driving probably more value than some of the dev and ops guys did in their first experiments. I think if we can try to keep that in the back of our mind, that we're not trying to like win some game about how many cross-site scripting instances we can eliminate, but maybe how many, unsafe platforms or unsafe coding behaviors we can eliminate, then you start getting the kind of results that he's been getting, and it's intoxicating.
Very nice. So the coding errors and stuff, that's a function of education, right? I mean, it's hard enough with implementing DevOps and using the DevOps model. You've got developers that are running at 110, 120% utilization at their companies, at most companies, at least ones that I know of. How do you get them to take the time to stop and take a breath and take a course or education? How do you get them you know, with, along with their existing, you know, plate of stuff, how do you stop and let them do education and still maintain your continuous deployment stuff?
I mean, Gene should tell the brakeman tighter feedback loop phenomenon, but
In fact, I was just flipping to that page. Yeah, you know, I think the way to do what I love these patterns of just giving feedback to developers as part of their work. At Twitter, I think the equivalent of the most revolutionary story in security, it was a Twitter presentation about how they recovered from the, in 2009, they had three, very high profile security breaches, and they got an FTC trade injunction, that said thou shalt be secure for the next 25 years. And it was actually three engineers who basically created this tool chain and to put static code analysis, do dynamic testing in the production environment, despite the fact that, the dev and ops people were already, underwater. Mm-hmm. And one of them was Justin Matottle, Alex Mullen. One of them had written Breakman, Justin Collins. And so this is, a static code analysis for Ruby on Rails. And, they, basically integrated this into the deployment pipeline. This is a wonderful graph. I'm actually looking at it right now. That shows the number of vulnerabilities over time going down, right? It's just, because people could see, the security vulnerabilities as they were being written. Another example came from Nick Galbraith. He was the head of security for Etsy for many years. And, so a lot of DevOps people, they're used to seeing graphs. Here's how many, pages we're getting. Here's how many shopping cart ads, completed transactions and so forth. One of the things that he did was put how many SQL injection attacks are we seeing, right? And all these very make very visible, the hostile environment that their code is operating in. And, suddenly you have people suddenly caring about security and learning about, all right, what are the best countermeasures to prevent, detect, and recover from SQL injection, because they have firsthand evidence of it happening to their code. And so what was very maybe theoretical became, absolutely, something that they need to fix that day. So I think it's, those are the things, like, what can we do to put in very visible places, the security aspects of the work that they're doing?
Yeah, and there are other operational benefits you can get too. Like when I was at Akamai, the idea that you could very, very quickly spin up new trusted images meant that first of all, they would instrument the bejesus out of everything. So fan speed, CPU temperature, all these different things. And could treat something like a 5%, uptick in temperature or CPU as like proof of compromise or an indicator of compromise, and then scorch the thing and rebuild trusted bare metal. And, the kind of nimble response means that you can treat your servers like, cattle and not like pets. And you can do things like Netflix does, and you can have the chaos monkey type of spirit. But also, like, one of the things that I did a lot even before the DevOps part was I would look at the kind of once you start instrumenting and measuring stuff, I tried to look at the defects not by line of business but by implementation language. And it seemed to me that, a disproportional amount of the security findings from the AppSec teams were in PHP. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't saying you can't do secure PHP, but I said clearly your organization can't. So how about, stop just, doing these things in willy-nilly everything. Seems like a lot of your, high-severity customer-facing issues in this particular portal, how about just no new projects on PHP without a justification, right? Mm-hmm. Because qualitatively, it's almost the same thing with the memory leaks they started. It's like you can either be more careful or choose type-safe languages and things like that, right?
Yeah. Very cool. All right. Well, gentlemen, I've got one last question, and then I'm going to let you all go. What does the future of DevOps look like, or are we as DevOpsy as we can get at this point? I'm going to start with Josh, and we'll finish up with Gene.
Everything theoretically will peter out eventually, and I think for some of the early adopters of DevOps, they kind of some of them felt like they hit a plateau. And even at Gene's conferences, when they were showing their charts, you know, they did this, they did this, they did all the things you're supposed to do, and they're starting to see, a plateau. But back to that gears analogy, I think once we started introducing the supply chain principles, they were able to hit a new plateau, a higher plateau. And I'm hoping there's waves and waves of other really cool boosts we can get and improvements we can get through that kind of spirit of continuous improvement and experimentation. And there's plenty of room for the security tribe to merge with the DevOps tribe and find some of those right now. Mm-hmm. And not only will we be heroes, but we're also going to be taken more seriously. And when we have to get to the much harder stuff that is zero sum, we're going to have a lot more permission and trust built to be able to, you know, draw upon that.
Okay. Gene?
Yeah, I think, you know, where are we on the, you know, from zero to done? You know, I think we're at 5%. So IDC says there's, you know, about 8 million developers on the planet. There's about 8 million ops people on the planet. And, you know, I guess if we just do the math, that means there's probably half a million security people on the planet. And so, you know, if that means only 5% are, you know, being able to work in this system where, you know, we're able to be more agile, be more secure, be more reliable, that's a shame. In fact, we also found that these high performers, they have lower rates of burnout. They have higher job satisfaction. They're twice as likely to recommend to friends their organization is a great place to work, right? They have a sense of meaning in their work. So, you know, to say that for anyone, whenever I hear someone say, you know, is a passing fad, it's like, no, we have 95% more to go, right? That we all deserve to be, you know, have those amazing benefits. So, you know, I think the best is yet to come, and we're really at the beginning. So I think a call to action would be, if you're working in DevOps, you know, be able to share that journey with others, and you know, say that the water's safe, and you know, it's a great ride, and you know, bring others into the community. I think that's a wonderful thing. If you haven't experienced it yet, you know, there's wonderful communities out there, like DevOps Days. That RSA with those DevOps Connect, where it's about a security perspective into the DevOps movement. I think all of those are just awesome. Any place we can get a chance to go to those, I couldn't recommend it more highly. It's just invigorating. And for me, there's nothing more fun than learning. And I never learn as much as I do, you know, at these type of conferences.
Very cool. Yeah, I've always been an advocate of, seems like a lot of the InfoSec people kind of preach to the choir when they go to the Black Hat or the DEF CONs or the Derby CONs or the Shmoo CONs. And, you know, I was like, I see all these things on Twitter. It's like, hey, here's a, you know, PHP, here's PyCon, here's PHP CON, here's DevOps Days. You know, the folks that are, you know, rock stars in the InfoSec community who's talking at Shmoo CON should probably turn around and take these talks or create talks that are, I don't want to say dev friendly, but, you know, digestible for developers at conventions for PHP or for Python to show, you know, what they can do to help, you know, improve their own code. And I'm sure they have tracks for security tracks at these developer cons. I don't know how popular they are because I've never actually been to one, but I would imagine that that would help get our message out there instead of just preaching to the choir like we're so used to doing.
In fact, yeah. That's so true. Josh, please tell the story about how we've actually been able to do that and what the reception has been.
Yeah, I mean, there's we've been trying, again, parallel experimentation, but if you do come to RSA, and I hope you do, the best part of that week is actually Monday before it starts. RSA, you know, really saw that the talks we had been doing were getting some traction. They said, how do we get more developers to start coming to to RSA? I said, I'm not sure you can or you should. Maybe we should create something for them. So we have a free conference all day that RSA gives a space for rugged DevOps, where at least half the speakers were developer and DevOps people. So we were merging our tribes, not just, you know, talking amongst ourselves. And we've also encouraged most of those folks to take topics to DevOps Days, to GoToCon, to other, you know, to Java 1, because... And not to get a security talk per se, but something that contributes value to the community itself. And we're seeing more and more of these folks not only speaking at the cons, but maybe running like little one day and half day tracks as well. Because if, you know, one of the problems we said with the OWASP, I said as a design goal, you should aim to have more than 50% developers. And so far, the only AppSec USA I've ever seen do that was the one that James Wickett ran in LastCon, right? Mm-hmm. He had, I think, 60% developers. Because if the go, if you really want to merge our value and knowledge, you have to, you know, commingle.
Yeah, that's a good thought. I just saw that on the Austin ISSA group. The LASCON is going to be going on. It's happening very soon.
It's one of my favorite conferences of the year, and yeah. I think it's because they aim for unifying tribes, and they have a great attitude, great food, great beer, great music. Like, it's just the culture is just right for this kind of union.
Yep. LASCON.org, LASCON. It's in Austin, Texas. The conference is third and fourth, but there'll be 2-day training sessions held on November 1st and 2nd. A lot of great people down there. Mr. Betcher from our shows down, he lives in Austin. It's just a really great town Austin is, and if you can get a chance to go to LASCON, it really should be something you should check out. So there's a discount code on the ISSA international website. I guess if you're a member of ISSA, you can get a discount code for that. Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure. I've heard Josh and Gene on numerous podcasts that I've followed through the years, and I'm glad you guys decided to turn your massive eyes down to my side of the world here. I want to start with Josh first, because we did the introductions opposite. Hmm. So how would people get a hold of you if they wanted to talk about anything, security or developer related or anything?
Easiest to find these days on Twitter, I guess, at Josh Corman, JOSHCORMAN, or at okay. I Am The Cavalry.
Okay. Are you going to be speaking anywhere in the near future? I know you just got back from an overseas flight. Yeah. I appreciate you taking the time to come on. So,
Funny, after giving a little guff to OWASP, next week is AppSec USA in DC, and we're doing a talk on IoT safety on Thursday. But also, one of our buddies, Mark Miller, is running convinced OWASP to have a whole rugged DevOps track on Friday. So we're inviting lots of developers all day. James Wickett will be there. I'll be there. A bunch of the people, you know, unifying our tribes will be presenting content for the DC crowd. So I'll be there next Thursday and Friday.
Excellent. Gene, how would people get a hold of you if they wanted to, places you might be in the next 2 to 3 months?
Yeah, best way to reach me, I think, is Twitter at RealGeneKim, or just email me at GeneKim@itrevolution.com. And the conference that I'll be at for the remainder of the year on my calendar is DevOps Enterprise Summit. It's a conference I run, you know, where large, complex organizations, leaders in those, are talking about their DevOps transformation. So it's the fourth conference over 3 years that we've done, and. Wow. I'm super looking forward to it. And also, by the way, if anyone is interested in the DevOps handbook, we're making available the first 140 pages free. So if you're interested in that, there'll be instructions in terms of how to get that. But just look for a 140-page free excerpt for DevOps handbook. And Brian, I'll send that to you as well.
Is that going to be on your site, or are you going through O'Reilly or NoScorch or somebody?
I'll send you the download instructions. But yeah, it's on itrevolution.com.
Okay.
I will point out, though, it doesn't get until page 313 until they start talking about the value and benefit of rugged DevOps in baking security.
Wow, 300 feet
backwards.
All right,
but we're in here.
Awesome. I'll definitely have the link to that in the show notes when Gene sends that to us, gentlemen. Like I said, if you guys ever want to, you know, come back on the show, if you want to talk about DevOps, if you got something you guys want to pimp out or anything that you're working on, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. It's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're fantastic. Thank you so much. And catch you soon, guys.
Right on. And that was it for Breaking Down Security this week. Have a great week, and we'll talk to you again soon. And we're clear. Right on. Excellent, gentlemen. All thank right. you.
Hey, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Gene. Josh, go get some sleep, sir.
Yeah, I'm tired.
Right on. Okay. All right. Excellent. Have a good night, sir.
If you get Jardine, though, even if it's just a short little addendum that you stick into some other show, I mean, we should talk this out because this is just one of the most circular things that ever happens. It's like somebody really wants it to be better, but they don't want to do the transition period. And nothing in history happens in one fell swoop. You don't get racism in one fell swoop. You don't get, you know, voting rights in one fell swoop. It's always a multi-stage maneuver. And I just want to get people to stop wanting perfection instantaneously and maybe figure out, all right, what's the next 3 years look like? Can we at least agree on what we do for the next 3 years? Yeah. And then figure out where we want to end up.
Yeah, that's one of the eight ways I saw. I was doing research for this, and it was one of eight ways of failing in DevOps. You were expecting to, you know, have immediate results when in fact you need to kind of have patience and know that change takes time. And especially when you're doing a culture change or something like that, it takes a lot of time and effort, and you can't expect to find, you know, these things overnight. It's not an overnight change.
Yeah. And I wasn't going to inject this in here, but the last thing to think of is if you fancy yourself a white hat hacker, use fucking social engineering, right? I mean, this is
sure.
like just without manipulating them, just use your ability to mirror and use their language and just pretexting and framing and like,
yep.
That's some way to be more effective than just saying your code sucks.
Learn how to read people and know what motivates them to make that change. Yeah, exactly.
All right.